Kind of started out on guitar and played some guitar and keyboards, and I, like everybody, actually wanted to be a drummer. But my dad was a Navy guy in Japan when I was in, I guess, ninth grade or something. He was supposed to bring me back a big kit of drums, and he spent all his money on whatever, but he brought me back a guitar. So anyway, I was a guitar player for a long time. And then when I switched to bass back in Gainesville, I think I just, you know, you just start doing all that things high, and but you got to, you know, put it in a tasteful place. So with the band, I guess I would do that, you know, like you were talking about, yeah, American Girl and Breakdown. We had a couple interesting guys that produced and engineered that record at the notorious 5112 Hollywood Boulevard. It was like an old office building. We were rehearsing on the second floor. And then one day, from Tulsa, the Shelter studio moved in, and our rehearsal space became a studio, a 16-track studio. So it had like some limitations. And Danny Cordell was the Shelter guy, and he was the guy that was producing it. I mean, he wasn't there all the time, but he was the coolest guy. He would like hum you a part or something, or just give you some ideas, or go, yeah, he got an idea for that. And I go, well, not yet. And he'd go, well, you know, hum something. And you go, oh yeah, I'll try that. And then, but these two guys, Max and Army Dick, they were so funny. They were really high all the time. And I think they probably suggested, hey, why don't, you know, American Girl, why don't you do something up high, you know, so you just, it's in D, you know, so you just, you know, there's only a couple. And then, if I'm not mistaken, I never do it live, but I think near the end of that on the recording, they had me, and it was really the stoner's idea. It was to do, you know, is going, you know, going. So that's on the record all through the end. Just playing a simple groove is a little harder than it looks, you know, and there's kind of no big secret to it. I mean, when you play with a really good drummer like Ferroni, you know, like my thing is just listening to what he does and then tucking my thing kind of underneath what he's doing. So he's really, I mean, if I'm looking good, it's just because I'm kind of riding on his coattails. You know, I mean, he's doing a killer groove, and then I just try to, you know, just, and I can feel him looking at me, like if I'm rushing it, like bass players, or he called me a Russian one day or something. You're rushing it. I don't know. Are you European or something? But yeah, whatever. But so anyway, I can feel him staring at me, you know, like, oh, I'm Russian, you know, but, you know, in rock and roll, I mean, sometimes the guitars are a little edgy and they're a little out front, and maybe the drums are a little behind, and then the bass can kind of be somewhere in the middle. Like you can't groove so far back that you make the guitar player sound like they're on a fast train to, you know, wherever. But right. And my thing is just getting with Ferroni and making sure that kind of mystical thing happens, that like when you hear an old record, like a Stax record or something, you hear the bass drum and the bass are doing that kind of interesting thing. Yeah. And I've studied it a little bit. Like I mean, you can only get so much sound out of a speaker, you know, even a little speaker will sound good, but it's like, if everything's hitting, you know, at the same moment, it's kind of what's happened to music. That's why it sounds so shitty, folks, you know, but the old records and the groovier records are things are kind of placed in peculiar ways that most engineers want to, I'm going to fix that. And I say, don't fix it, folks. Leave it the way it is.